NBC, the ongoing situation there in Gaza. We've been following new developments as the Israeli ground troops, an estimated 10,000 of them, had massed along the border and then headed into the Gaza Strip in a massive ground assault. It now appears that the tanks and the armored vehicles have made it closer to the population centers. Much of the electricity is cut to the area, and so they're going in with night vision goggles. We're hearing some reports now that 30 to 40 Hamas soldiers have been killed. That's according to the Israeli forces. Hamas says it has killed 4 to 5 Israeli soldiers, but so far no confirmation of that at this point. And we are continuing to look ahead to the Security Council for the United Nations having a big meeting. It begins at 7 p.m. Eastern time, and reporters will not have access to that meeting. But what we know from the French spokesperson here is that the consultation was called just a short time ago. There was a back and forth, apparently, between France and Libya. We don't know the nature of this, but this is when the consultation for the Security Council was called. They will have a public meeting, apparently, on the situation, but the meeting among the Security Council members itself will be closed to reporters. The ambassadors are expected to speak beforehand, as we have cameras and reporters there at the United Nations. We will follow that, of course, for you when it happens about an hour and 15 minutes from now. But in the meantime, there is an international crisis developing, conflicting decisions about whether to support what Israel is doing, whether to support what Hamas is doing, or whether to just to try and influence a ceasefire here. Let's talk to Rahida Dergham, who's the senior diplomatic correspondent for Al Hayat newspapers and an MSNBC analyst. Rahida, what we're seeing is that the French now have condemned this ground assault on the part of the Israeli Defense Force. They've also condemned the firing of rockets by Hamas. And at the same time, the European Union president, who happens to be Czech, is saying, look, we see what's happening with Israel on the ground as being defensive, not offensive. Where is this this diplomatic standoff going to end? And how has what has happened even in the last couple weeks going to play into what happens today with the Security Council meeting?
Well, the presidency of the Security Council is now for France. France, as you know, was the president of the EU, the European Union, where now it's being held by the Czech. There definitely may be differences amongst the Europeans in how to term what's going on, but the president of France, Sarkozy, was to be going, or maybe still is to be going, to Israel and to Ramallah to try to do something on the ground. He was hoping that they will fix things on the ground, then come back to the Security Council to have a resolution that will, if you will, formalize whatever agreement the parties reach and make it more committal to all parties concerned. Now, also, Sarkozy was going to be going to Damascus so that Damascus, the president of Syria, Bashar al-Assad, would influence Hamas. As you know, leadership of Hamas also resides in Damascus. And the French were hopeful. My information actually is that Sarkozy called the president of Palestine, Mahmoud Abbas, today when he was in Amman, and he told him to please go back to Ramallah, because he wanted to meet with him in Ramallah before he comes here to New York to the Security Council for that public meeting next week. So there's been a lot of French flurry to make things happen on the ground. They were hoping to do that, and then, of course, the ground invasion changes the picture. But altogether, the talk was about having monitors on the ground between Gaza and Israel, the reopening of the crossings. All of these ideas have been thought about by the international community. At this point, the priority is to stop the fighting.
I want to mention that Libya is right now one of the non-permanent members of the Security Council, along with a handful of other nations, and of course then the 5 permanent members, which include the United States and the United Kingdom. What we're hearing is that this meeting that's supposed to take place in just a little more than an hour began because there was a flurry of back and forth between the Libyans, again, members of the Security Council, and France, also members of the permanent member of the Security Council. And we're hearing that Libya may put a declaration on the table. Do you have any information about what Libya may be thinking when it comes to the way the international community intervenes?
First of all, you have the five permanent members who hold the veto power. That means if one of the permanent members says no to a resolution or no to a statement by the Security Council, you would know that this is not going to happen, whereas Libya is an elected member and it does not have such a power. So the balance is a bit different. Libya is not speaking for all of the Arabs, although for the moment I would assume that they are upholding the Arab position, which says move now. Get the Security Council to issue a statement now to stop the invasion. They are very embarrassed. They would be very embarrassed if they do nothing while the Israeli invasion causes tremendous harm to civilians, more even than has already been caused. The idea, the original idea before the ground invasion was that the foreign ministers, Arab foreign ministers, who are on their way to New York today and tomorrow, they would start their meetings on Monday, including the Libyan foreign minister, the Saudi, and several others. And they would start to talk to the members of the Security Council regarding the different elements of a resolution that would really have a durable ceasefire.
Ceasefire. In fact, because you've brought this up, let me, Rahida, thank you and send it over to Chris Jansing. I understand we may get some more information about what the Israelis may think about a ceasefire. Chris. UN Security Council meeting. Let's talk to Rahida Durgam, who is the chief senior diplomatic correspondent for Al Hayat newspapers and MSNBC analyst. And Rahida, I was reading a column that you wrote recently concerning this very situation, and it's rather pessimistic in terms of when you're analyzing the outcome of the situation between the Palestinians and the Israelis, rather pessimistic when it comes to hoping for a solution.
Well, in case there is a failure of the two-state solution, that's already bad enough, and that's what would be happening if things continue unattended to by the international community. But there is also further the possible collapse not only of Hamas, but of the Palestinian Authority, in which case we'll have chaos, and then, you know, all bets are off. So it's a very dangerous situation, and that is why it's important that the messages coming from Washington, particularly from President-elect Barack Obama, is to sort of set it straight for all concerned, for example, to Hamas and Iran and Hezbollah.
Well,
and their
how
friends.
Creative would any suggested solution have to be in order to address the concerns of the Israelis and the Palestinians, who, let's face it, have generations behind them of not being able to agree on a way to proceed?
The Israelis do have a Palestinian partner for negotiations. It's the Palestinian Authority, the President Mahmoud Abbas. He is the body and he is the legitimate negotiator with Israel. So let's get back straight to these negotiations. Do not give Hamas the upper hand in terms of the future of the Palestinians. After all, Hamas has taken the Palestinians to this war without authorization in effect. But the fact of the matter is that also the President of the United States, be it now President Bush or President-elect Obama, must also make sure that the U.S. remains committed and tells all concerned the following, that the two-state solution is a must, that the security and independence of Jordan is an American commitment, that the instability in Egypt is unacceptable, and you know, basically it's in the American national interest to have, you know, things moving towards a solution of this so that both parties do not dig a further trap for one another. What will happen tonight at the Security Council, I'll tell you quickly what will take place. There will be there will be no resolution tabled this evening. There will not be one. But the idea is to safeguard that or not endanger that resolution and go for a statement just to deal with the ceasefire.
Rahida, thank you for that. Let's talk to